Hey everybody, super chill stream. You know, I haven't streamed in quite a while, a few months, but yeah, just gonna sleeve up the cards in this game, Lands of Galzyr, which is a really fun little RPG styled game by people who made Dale of Merchants. So just gonna go through and do that. Might adjust the camera here to get more of a close up. That's it. Not gonna really talk a ton because the mic is a little farther away from me than normal. Just didn't feel like bringing in a closer mic, and my voice is kind of tired today, so don't really want to wear it out. But yeah, I'm here. I'm listening. Watching chat, you know, not super closely, but I'll look over every now and then. Let's get into it. There we go. First card. Yeah, I don't know. There's like spoilers in the card, so I'll probably put them slightly off camera, face up, to remember which ones I've done. One sec. I'm going to grab the tray from the box so that it, because these are starting to get kind of slippy and this stack doesn't seem super sturdy. So one sec. Also, I forgot there are dividers in the box that I need to punch out, so let me grab those too. In the box, these are kind of weirdly out of order. I just got, like, it started around 300, and then randomly in the middle, it was like 304, 305, and there was like a big chunk missing, and now I'm down to, it jumped back down to like 241. Bizarre, but I mean, I'm just putting them in order. So it's not too difficult or anything. Oh, and as you can see, these are double-sided. There's just a winter and a summer side, which I think... It looks like they're just identical aside from aesthetics. But yeah, they're numbered on both sides, 239. It's in the corner here. All right, fourth pack out of 8. We got 8 packs of sleeves. I think we're getting close to the middle. How long have we been going? Where's the number? I haven't streamed in a while. About half an hour, so that's not terrible. Let me get some water. I gotta tell you, you guys might hear when I'm talking in the background. I'm listening to Talkin' Tunes with Rob Paulson, a fantastic podcast featuring the voice of, you know, Raphael, Carl Weezer, Pinky from Pinky and the Brain, Yakko Warner from Animaniacs, and he and the voice of the brain, as Pinky and the Brain are doing Who's On First, and it's just, oh, it's hilarious. Check it out, you know, Spotify, whatever podcast app, it'll just say Who's On First. with Pinky in the Brain. It's so funny.
Oh my god.
All right, we're getting there. Probably won't be too much longer now. I think I might be able to get it within an hour, maybe a little over, you know. Pretty chill, impromptu stream. It'd be nice if I had a little more audio, but the way I have things set up. You know what? Let me see if I can... Okay, that's pretty quiet, but you guys might be able to hear it, so, yeah, just, let me know. I mean, I can also talk from over here. Just sounds a little better if I get closer.
Broadcasting movies and all that, that there's these great opportunities. And it's still, though, it still is driven by passion.
Yeah.
And you know, the rich not the poor, which is better, I get that. I gotta make a living. But the money comes as a result of doing something about which you're passionate. And you guys, I don't care if it's performing, flower arranging, working on automobiles, or owning your own body shop, man. If you get up in the morning and you can do something that you would essentially do for free, and people find a way
that's
to pay you,
just do good work, something that you would, as you say, would do for free.
Yeah.
Money will follow.
It will.
It takes care of itself, literally, as long as you show up and do good work.
Yeah.
That should be the only goal.
It's the coolest thing, man. And the opportunity to bring this to you via this medium, via the podcast, when I meet you guys in various conventions around the world, essentially, all it does is make people happy. We walk into a room and people were at a restaurant and we don't get recognized. They find out who the brain is and we start doing, hey, God, look at you. And JC is messing with the camera. No. La, 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 la. And it immediately makes us go, it's great. He's probably laughing at the fact that an old man is doing that funny voice.
Well, you know what it is? It's that I guest teach every summer for my friend Ian Abrams.
Oh, yeah.
Who's a professor of television and movie scriptwriting. For Drexel University,
mm-hmm.
And he brings a program out here every summer, and they ask to assess, and he has some huge people, and every year he has me as one of his eight guests, and he's had some, Academy Award winners, writers, directors, actors, and then had me, and he describes me as his only
two-time
guest.
Two-time Emmy winner.
Right,
I mean,
but he describes me as his only guest that has a superpower.
Yeah, how about that? Is that what he says?
Yes.
I love that.
And so he introduces me without telling my name, and then he just has me do some voices. But at the end, at the end of the program, he has them assess.
Yeah.
Both him as a teacher and what they liked best. And one of the people who wrote in said, my favorite guest was Maurice LaMarche because he's from our childhood.
Oh, man.
And if you connect with something from your childhood, that's the purest time in
mm-hmm.
your life. And somebody who made you happy as a child, it resonates the most with you. And
how beautiful.
I was really touched by that letter.
Oh, yeah. And we see it now. We see it every time we meet people.
Yeah.
People stand in line, and they wait. They drive for hours, and all they want to do is have that connection.
Yeah. One of the things, handful of regrets about working with people in this business is that I missed Mel Blanc by 5 minutes
yeah.
once.
Really?
If I'd have been on time for the date,
twice,
I would have met him. And I knew I walked into a studio and it stuck his cigarettes.
Yeah.
I said, who's smoking in here?
Mel Blanc.
I said, Mel Blanc
yeah.
is in here. He was doing Heathcliff.
Right.
And I was like, oh man, I always wanted to meet Mel Blanc. He died shortly after.
Yeah.
I never got to meet him.
I'll tell you what, and now I know, and we're going to wrap this up, and thank you again for hanging
with us
on the first show.
But that's because he hits
right
me
here.
The way I guess
that's
you and
now,
I hit people
right.
who are in their 20s and 30s now.
It's
and
the most beautiful thing.
His kids.
Well, I worked with Mel
I
once,
yeah.
and I mustered up the courage to ask him Mr. Blank, if it's not too big of a problem, would you mind? And before I could get it out, he said, you know, what's up, Doc? And it just blew my mind.
Yeah, sure.
So now I get so excited. This passion or this wackiness you see before you is not contrived. It's not manufactured. Maurice and I leave these events, and the feedback I get from all you folks out there with our hearts full and our minds blown.
Listen, I'm going to walk out of here feeling that way from your crew and from your staff.
It's just delightful.
We you know, while we were warming up the mics, and even a few times they busted out and laughed while we've done the voices. It's just great to know that you've done something that lights people up a little bit.
And that is what we're going to be doing on Talking Tunes. That was what this is about. Maurice helped me kick it off. We're so grateful for you folks watching. Thank you, Glenn, Chris Hardwick, for giving me this opportunity. So we'll be bringing
props
you
to Chris.
Whole shit ton of happy for the
there
next however long that
lives. Yeah, just couldn't get to the end without swearing. There you go.
But what I do want to say is, and I know this is the truth, and this is our little tag. I've been saying this since the beginning of the podcast, and it's the truth. And I appropriated the line from Reader's Digest, in which they had at the back of every magazine, every week, they had laughter is the best medicine. And I appropriated it for my own use. So now I say, laughter is the best medicine. The cool thing is you can't OD, and the refills are free. And I'll tell you what, that is true. Thank you, my brother.
You bet, pal.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see you again. Thank you very much for giving us an opportunity. And
thanks for having me on your first,
my pleasure,
your first podcast.
For letting us in your home for 30 years. We'll be back again. And take care. Bye.
Now leaving Nerdist.com.
Hey folks, it's Rob, and if you love my Talking Tunes podcast, then you need to check out the video version on Nerdist. Really, it's the best way to experience it. So go watch the show over at ProjectAlpha.com, where you can sign up for a free 30-day trial. Check it out, ProjectAlpha.com. Oh, and one more thing.
Nerf!
Sorry.
Now entering Nerdist.com.
Hello, fans! Yeah, I wonder, you're mysteriously disguised as a middle-aged white guy here in Burbank. Thank you so much for joining us yet again. This is entirely too much fun, and particularly today, because I get a chance to talk with three people who are friends, but folks with whom I've not had the good fortune of working very much. But man, have we got some stuff to talk about. It is going to be mind-blowing. I'm telling you, it's really going to, when I say blow you, well, yeah, mind-blowing. That's the word I'm looking for. Two words I'm looking for. We are going to have Kevin Conroy, Batman, his own Bat Cell, Paul Dini, and Alan Burnett. We have a Batcast for these folks. And I know these folks have talked to a lot of people about the whole Batman ethos and legacy and all of that, but they've never talked to me. So we are going to enjoy the Batcast here on Talking Tunes. Na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na-na. Batman. How exciting is this? I mean, I can't even tell you, but I have to because I got to kill some time. We have Kevin Conroy, Paul Dini, Alan Burnett, three gentlemen who are responsible for, well, in the past, for making you, ladies and gentlemen, so incredibly excited about Batman, but in the next hour and change are going to be responsible for making you guys go, oh my God, oh my God, I can't believe it. He says, oh my God. So, without further ado, I'm going to shut up and we're going to start talking about all this stuff.
Oh man. This is an episode where they had Kevin Conroy, and if you haven't heard the news, Kevin Conroy died just a couple days ago, at 66. He was really, really pretty young, and I've been really bummed about it. Oh, thanks for lurking, Jason. Talking about kind of a sad thing of just Kevin Conroy, the voice of Batman from the animated series and the Arkham games, died recently in this podcast I'm listening to. He was on this, and yeah, he was just one of those guys that I really hoped I'd get a chance to work with someday, but oh well, you know, it's never gonna happen, but rest in peace, Kevin Conroy.
Three lunches because I didn't believe I could have guns and fistfights.
Oh, really? You didn't think you could do the do it justice?
Even though it was a primetime show?
Well, it was an afternoon show, right. But it was under children's programs.
So wasn't it originally primetime on Fox?
No, it moved over there.
Oh, it moved?
For a year, we were, or 13 weeks, we were up against 60 Minutes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they pulled that with Pinky in the Brain, too. Yeah.
So, yeah. Which was fine, I mean, you know.
Oh, yeah.
You might as well, you know, give it a shot.
Yeah.
And, so anyways, that's how I got over it.
Well, lucky them.
And me, I mean, it was great.
Yeah.
You know, they had started seriously. There was some development I didn't have to think about.
Right.
And I came to a recording, you were already Batman, and it was fantastic.
Which actually leads me to the next point. I did not know until I was doing some research on all you fellas, you're a, you're a fancy schmancy Juilliard person.
You didn't know?
I did not know that. I think because I went to college for 37 minutes.
Yes, I trained in the classical theater.
Yes. Apparently you did. I mean,
I was going to be like a Shakespeare stage actor.
Yeah, well, you did a lot of stage.
Who knew that that was not going to be a thing anymore?
All of us.
I was training for something that disappeared.
Yeah.
If it doesn't exist.
Yeah,
you can't make a living in the theater.
No, you can't. But.
But. I think that's why I got Batman.
Yeah.
Because I really had no exposure to Batman except for the Adam West show. And you guys, Paul Dini, Bruce Timm, explained to me in the audition, no, that's not the direction at all. This is a dark night. This is, his parents are killed as a child. So, you know,
it's very a dark
Bill
story.
Noir.
Yeah.
It's a very, very dark story. He's avenging their deaths.
Right.
And I used all that theater background and classical training, and I approached it like you'd approach Hamlet.
Can I just this is what I love so much about this opportunity, and Paul was talking about this before we started rolling, is that we are lifting, sort of pulling back the curtain on this medium. We know sort of how ubiquitous cartoons are. They've always been part of our culture, but
I'm an actor. It's so great to hear another actor say, well, I approached it like an acting gig. I approached it with my sensibilities as an actor. So it's not just blowing smoke when I say, you guys, it's not just about the funny voice.
No, I always say that to people come to me at Comic-Con. So yeah. How do I get in the business? First of all,
right.
It's not making funny voices.
Right.
It's acting.
Right. And these guys could hire anybody they wanted. Everybody would want to do Batman. But the fact that we're here talking about this show 20 years later,
I know.
And to many, no, I would say probably, certainly everybody here, and we're in this mean age group of sort of 25 to 35. My son, who's 33 years old, to him, Batman is you, and Mark is the Joker. Mm-hmm. That's it. He loves Chris Nolan, he loves Heath Ledger, he loves Chris Bale, Mike Key, all that stuff. But to that, what you guys have created and what the legacy you've left for people to enjoy for two generations now is a remarkable thing.
Well,
and to hear you talk about how you got that gig, that it's not just, I'm going to talk like Batman. You created a character that is fleshed out, that means something to people.
I think I was lucky that I had no background in it.
I
had no predisposed. I had nothing to fall back on.
Right.
So I had to approach it as an actor. I had to kind of come up with something
on the spot. That speaks to your training and how that works, though. Because if you're not trained that way, and you're not used to making decisions based on some, some process, then you're not going to be able to
improvisational instincts. Yeah.
Which improv is fine too. I've made a lot of money being able to think on my feet. But when you're creating something that has such already has a very deep fan base, but is not campy, and we can talk all day about how much we love Adam West. That is negative spin on Mr. West. Yeah.
Nope.
But for what you guys were doing and what you ultimately created, clearly you did the right thing and you chose the right actor. But for you to kind of go in and make those decisions only reinforces what we're talking about. And I love this opportunity because there are so many people who want to grow up and do what we do. Mm-hmm. And it ain't just a luck of the draw.
No. And so much of it is about the choice you make. Yeah. I mean, acting's about choices.
Yeah.
And Andrea told me that he saw over 500 people.
Yeah, they saw
500 people.
Over.
Yeah, they were kind of in despair.
They kept looking.
And
wow.
It was just making the right choice in that moment.
You know, there were a dozen other actors who could have made that choice,
that
but
choice.
They just didn't think of it.
Right, but so what a lovely thing. I think that when you write a book, Mr. Burnett can say, we were in despair until you came into the room. What a lovely thing.
That is a nice quote.
Oh, my God. You know.
Can I get that in writing?
Well, Batman always shows up when you need him the most.
Yeah, Mr. Dini, and I feel like I should call you Mr. Dini because you're a celebrated author, writer, 50,000 Emmys, all the other stuff. How did you go from a young man who did not want to speak to Bugs Bunny on the phone at 9 years old to being Mr. Dini, who we see today?
Even though I did not know that was Mel Blanc calling, and I thought it was a crank caller.
It's a story
for another time. There was nothing really I wanted to do besides cartoons.
You knew this as a child?
Yeah, there was cartoons, and my only career options as a kid, in that I thought about it at all, were something with cartoons and something with animals. You know, and I don't think they paid very well for you to run around the jungle or something. So, and cartoons doesn't pay all that much more. But anyway, it just seemed like a lot of fun. Like somebody was doing this stuff.
Yeah.
Somebody was employed to create this. And going to college, I studied creative writing and acting and journalism. And I just thought, well, that's getting me a grade, and I'm going to do something with cartoons out there. I have no idea what. It was just the great unknown. But I knew that somehow something would appear, and it did. And all the comic books and cartoons I had read and studied came into play, and I wound up getting a job, actually, while I was still in college.
Were you, Alan, were you a fan, specifically of Batman in particular, when you were a kid?
Yes. Batman kind of in fits and spurts. I liked the TV show as a kid, and then about a year or two after watching it, it kind of became silly to me, because I thought that what was cool about it originally was the mix of darkness and humor, and then I thought it got way into silliness.
It's a camp,
when you have Batman surfing against the Joker, and they're just putting on bathing suits over their tights. It's right. Like,
well, now see, I do that anyway.
Yeah.
And you know, goddamn it, I find it comfortable.
Yeah.
You know, frankly, I just do it. My age, I like to put on a little Speedo over my pants.
Yeah.
Now,
occasionally
I get picked up by the police. But hey, at my age, I've earned the right to wear a Speedo over my pants.
Yeah.
Just saying.
Damn right.
But you were aware clearly of the real ethos of what Bob Kane wanted Batman to be about.
Well, yes, and also after the show was in syndication, I began reading comic books again, and there was a much more dramatic look to Batman. There's an artist, Neil Adams, who had come on to really redefine Batman in a very bold, powerful way. Denny O'Neill was writing the stories at that time, and he wanted to return Batman to more of his detective identity, mm-hmm. somebody who would actually fight more street criminals and get involved in mysteries than somebody who would fight the Penguin or the Riddler.
Got it.
Mm-hmm. And I felt that was a really interesting choice, and the stories were interesting. And
it also opens up the possibility for more stories.
Exactly,
yeah.
Exactly. And also, just the artwork changed. It had a bold look to it. So,
well, speaking of which, Jesus. God almighty, your show was really mind-bending.
So
the artwork, and Kevin was mentioning one of the unsung heroes. Well, I shouldn't say unsung. Unfortunately, she passed away, but Shirley Walker. Shirley Walker was the composer on Batman the Animated Series, and one of the beautiful things about that whole experience at Warner Brothers was the opportunity to have, world-class music.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And the extent to which that impacts any cinematic experience is so clear and so evident. And when you have that kind of juice for a TV show,
mm-hmm.
oh my God, that just that.
But that's why when you still see it now, you see them now, they still look so fresh.
Beautiful.
They're still so alive.
Yeah.
The whole symphony score mm-hmm. and the beautiful animation.
It really is remarkable.
Yeah.
And who was your team that decided these are the, this is what the Bat and his folks are going to look like, and the lines and the angles?
Well, I think that Bruce Timm did most of the character drawings, and Eric Radomski was the other producer, sort of was in charge of, the look and the production.
Yeah.
Last one.
Oh, my God. It holds up so beautifully, and I think one of the things that I love to see now, and I know all of you guys have done conventions, and we're talking about the fact that this is on a 12-year-old. It's pretty cool, but we have this great audience who didn't really. They knew us, but they didn't get a chance to really see who we are and meet us. And so now, you guys all go to Comic Con. I've been going forever and all of that. But it's so wonderful now to see the folks who line up to meet Kevin. And by the way, we all make it clear, I don't write them, and I don't draw them. I am an actor and a singer, and very grateful to be such. But I know who butters my bread. And I'm smart enough to know what I'm not smart at. But man,
all right. Looks like we got some additionals, which is why I didn't throw out this last thing.
Wonderful to see how the people react to what you guys have created, and they now watch it with their children. And often people start to tear up when they meet Kevin.
And these are for organization as you play the game.
They can get more personally invested in the character. So you develop a really personal relationship with the animated character that can much more than the live action character.
Well, and you would know that because you've done a lot of live action.
And they associate the animated character with your voice or my voice. So they really, there's an intimacy when you meet the audience that becomes friends. It's amazing that the personal story that you're about kids who had horrible childhoods or rough family lives or grew up in the inner city or something, and their one outlet was Batman.
Yeah.
And it's my voice they associate with the character. So they kind of invest that in me.
Yeah.
And it's not me. It's
right.
It's
that's because we get it. It's the character. That's famous.
We
but
get sort of the residual glow.
We do. We definitely, we sort of get a chance to enjoy the fruits of your collective.
Yeah,
labor.
Exactly.
And
you're the creator.
And we're so grateful for that. But yeah, but the thing is that, I can never say this enough. I mean, we know from going to a lot of these conventions that there are, without question, a certain number of folks
somewhere on the autism spectrum.
A lot.
And it is so deeply touching to see how the, for whatever reason,
isn't that interesting?
You're the shiny object. And man, when I see a couple of parents who bring in their grown child, who but for this circumstance...
I think I messed it up. You know, this talks about shuffling and other random stuff in there.
And they step back, and their little boy, who might be 25 or 30...
Well, let's go through that at least.
The parents are a mess because they're not being judged. Their little boy or little girl is getting a chance to connect with what it is that gets them out of their head.
Isn't it interesting?
Oh, my goodness.
So many kids are coming for on the spectrum.
It is, and it's beautiful.
And how they relate to the animated characters.
Unbelievable.
All right, going to set up all the punchboard stuff.
We all have experienced that because we're getting a paycheck and we're doing what we love to do. But here you are creating something that has literally had a profound effect on people's lives for 20 years plus.
Well, you know, it's like when I was a kid, I would, you know, see in the newspaper... Adam West or Roy Rogers or somebody of that time who would make an effort and dress up and go to a hospital to see kids.
Right.
And right now we have Johnny Depp and some of the heroes, the actors who play the heroes in the Marvel movies doing the same thing. So it is, it's quite a responsibility to have a little bit of that overflow in our own lives when we meet somebody who says that work touched them.
Yeah.
That it means something, either as a personality in your case or as a creative person in ours. And that does come with a responsibility. Those are our bosses, you know. And
well said.
And we, and so we owe it to them to be a little respectful, to spend some time to say thank you for you know, following our work.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The only time I ever put the suit on, I used to volunteer on weekends with foster kids at a facility outside of L.A., and they had a Halloween party every year. And somehow word got out that what my job was, right? They figured it out. So they came to me, will you wear the suit? Please, will you wear the suit to the party?
Only if I can put my Speedo on over my jeans.
I said, what suit? They said, you know, your work suit,
your
the
work
Batman suit. I said, I'm the voice. And they said, oh, come on, you got to do it. So I went to a Hollywood costume shop. And I bought a Batman suit.
No way.
Pictures.
That is
amazing. But I had to arrive.
Yeah.
I couldn't go hide in the bathroom and put it on, you know. So I had to arrive. So I'm driving on the 10 freeway as Batman at like 6 in the morning.
But not the Batmobile, so what were you driving?
And so this is a Volvo station wagon, right, with the cowl and thing. And these truckers are going by early in the morning. Honk, honk. Hey, Batman, tell Alfred to wash your car.
Yeah, nice.
You know, it was so humiliating.
Tell me you were humming the song.
It's the only time I've ever had the suit on. But it made it all worthwhile. I got there, I got out of the car, they're like, Batman's here, and they
but
came running
your
down
mouth,
the hill.
And then you start speaking, and oh my God, that's just got to be mind-blowing.
Get in the Batcave.
You have two kids?
Three kids.
And were they Bat fans when you were doing the show?
Yeah, but you know,
it's different when you're old man.
It's different, it's different. I'll tell you, this last year I was doing a series, and I worked with a bunch of new writers, 7-8 new writers. And they kept telling me about, after we have our little meeting, they would say, you know, I used to run home to see Bat. It was in Point and Village, and from school. And how much it had an effect on them. And I thought, you know, I don't think about these things much. But this last year I'm thinking, there's a real creative effect going on.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And these are people who are working in CW shows and big
fans. You inspired them.
Yeah, it made me feel good.
Well,
that does make you feel good, doesn't
it?
It
does.
I know your work affects somebody.
It really does, and I think because
you really can't tell sometimes, you know.
No.
When Batman ended, I really didn't see the effect it had on animation. I really didn't. Mm-hmm. And I thought, okay, it's a series that had its moment, and it will go.
And I put braces on my kids' teeth, like a normal person, and I was grateful. And
I
hear you, but boy, with these opportunities like this great opportunity that Chris and the folks here at Nerdist and Legendary Pictures have given me, I don't get recognized more than I used to because of the nature of
the internet.
But what's so delightful is you start telling these people, oh my God, all these people really, they just love Pinky and the Brain or Ninja Turtles or whatever. And it is the most delightful thing to know that it was more than just a paycheck and that you've had this lasting effect. And now these people who are creative were inspired by Batman, were inspired by this, you know, work. And
everybody wants to be appreciated.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Human nature.
It is. And it's so, I'm so grateful now, you know, I kid around, but I'm getting old. And I'm still grateful to be able to work and do my gig and nobody cares what I look like. But the fact that the work that we've all had this great opportunity to be involved with has had not only a positive effect, but an inspirational effect to the extent that people say, I want to be Alan Burnett. I want to be Paul Dini. Yeah. I want to do something like Kevin Conroy. Is huge and almost incalculable in terms of what it means to me.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. Well, it makes you feel like a musician or an actor or somebody else in the creative fields that what not normally associated with animation. And I think that's because animation has grown largely through the exposure and also through the creation of, you know, pretty good shows. So it means much more to generations coming up than it did to our parents.
Absolutely.
Where it was cheap, disposable entertainment.
It was a way to put the kid in front of the TV and...
Right, yeah, exactly. Right. This is really something that's a part of their culture, just as books like Treasure Island and Winnie the Pooh were parts of our parents' lives. You know, mm-hmm. They're something that they're very fond of when they're children, and they keep with them throughout their adulthood and pass on to their kids.
Well, and also with the addition of all these new platforms, platforms like Animaniacs has been on Netflix now for over a year. And when it showed up there a year ago, my Twitter feed exploded. And so now that it's been on for a while, when I get to go meet people who are 35, 40 years old, talk about appointment TV, and they'd say, maybe smoke a little reefer, or have a couple of pops, and go watch Animaniacs or Pinky and the Brain and Batman and all this stuff when I was in college. And now I get to watch it with my kids, and they love this stuff.
Yeah.
And it really holds up beautifully. It is utterly timeless. And when I was a kid, my son was born, I was, 28, 29 years old. Mm. And so when he started watching television, he was falling in love with the Muppets and Big Bird, which I could watch all day. If my kid had come along a little later and wanted to watch Teletubbies and Barney, I'd have shoved a gun in my mouth. Okay, honey, it's your turn to watch Teletubbies today. And I get why the rudimentary nature of that show works. I get that. But in terms of sharing the enjoyment of watching that with your kid, not even close. But to be able to watch Animaniacs or Batman with your kid, and so I say, I get all the cultural references now that I didn't get, but it doesn't matter because I love Batman, and this is such a pure, lovely interpretation of that whole mythology.
Yeah.
And I can watch it all day with my kid. Mm-hmm. So that is happening a lot.
Yeah.
And you got to add something to the whole circumstance because of Harley Quinn.
Yeah, I was very lucky.
Wonderful character.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for allowing her to be in the
Now,
the
how
episode.
Did that happen, though?
She
did
just
you...
took off.
She did take off.
Because you created Harley Quinn.
What happened was I was writing an episode for Alan. Actually, I had not come back on staff. I think it's time off to write a movie, and I'm sort of done with Warner's. And they said, do you want to come back and work on Tiny Toons? Do you want to work with Alan on Batman? And I'd done some development with Bruce Timm and Mitch Bryan, higher friend of Bruce's, on the Batman Bible. And then it was passed over to other people. And my deal came up when I left for a while. And then I met Alan, and it sounded like he had taken the better elements of the Bible and was building on that. It wasn't a step backwards to softer Batman stories, because when we came up with that initial Bible, we wanted to push it as far as we could go.
Now, how long have you been working on Batman before you took your break?
Off and on. Back then, you had an overall deal with Warner, so, you know, here, we need something written on Batman.
Oh, so they would slide you from show to show.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, so it would be fairly fluid. I'd be writing in the middle of a Tiny Toons, and then Bruce would say, can you come in and write Batman for, you know, for an afternoon or something. So he'd go, you know, back and forth while he's doing it. But when I met with Alan, I liked him a lot, and I liked where he was going with the stories. And we talked about a few of them, and he said, I'd sure like to have you freelance a few. So I said, sure. And The first one I wrote was Heart of Ice, which was the Mr. Freeze story.
And who was Mr. Freeze in your show?
Michael and Sarah.
Yeah. Who, interestingly, terrific actor, but when I was a kid, he played all the
Indians.
He played all the Native American roles.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought, here's Michael and Sarah. Oh, my God. Anyway, he's not a Native American.
And the second script I wrote was Joker's Favor. And I wanted to write a Joker story because I like the character a lot. And I thought, well, the Joker is terrorizing. The real story is about Joker. The Joker terrorizing a little guy who kind of strays into his path. And I thought, well, let's give him a gang. And he always has a couple of colorful henchmen and a couple of thug types. And I thought, let's throw a girl in there because that's sort of a nod back to the 60s show where the Riddler and Joker and Penguin would always have a girl hench person. Mm-hmm. And I just thought, what if she's funny? What if she gets funny lines and the Joker glares at her and the thugs laugh at her jokes and they don't laugh at the Joker's and then the Joker can get really mad. And I just thought of somebody kind of bright and quippy, like a Judy Holliday type. And for some reason, I like the name Harley Quinn, and I pitched it to Alan and Bruce, and they said that, you know, that's fine, and we'll go with that. And I wrote the script.
Stories, but I just thought it sounds kind of cool.
But didn't you have Arlene in mind?
I had a terrific actress. I did know Arlene Sorkin before that. We had actually gone to college together and only vaguely crossed paths, but we got to know each other better afterwards. And I knew her as a writer and performer around that time.
Oh, I didn't know she wrote.
Oh, yeah.
She's a terrific actress. I've always enjoyed her.
And she had done a lot of sitcom development and things like that. And a lot of things kind of came together. I saw her, I was homesick one day, and she'd given me a tape of her appearances on Days of Our Lives. And I was watching her, and she was playing a jester, actually, in like a Pied Piper outfit.
Okay, there's some other stuff. I'm going to DM them on Twitter to see if I messed things up by putting them into the full correct order. So I'll find out, but in the meantime, that's pretty much it. So thanks for watching, everybody. I'll be back with an actual gameplay stream this weekend. That's the plan. So thanks for watching. We're going to raid over to Jason Payne James since he was nice enough to lurk.
Sense of timing and that sense of approaching a character in a totally different way.
Right.
When Alan and Bruce.
All right. Let's raid over.
All the guys would sit around and talk about characters.
Gotta open the Twitch app. This is gonna take a minute.
Reference to the most obscure characters, and we instantly know what we're talking about.
Yeah. And
actors, except for maybe Mark Hamill, who beats us all because he's the Uber Maven.
Well, plus he's also a fanboy.
Oh yeah,
fanboy.
But they all bring something. They all bring something different. And because Mark is a fanboy, in his case, he does a lot of research. So if we were doing an adaptation of a Joker story, he would go to his file, which he's got in his in his Mark cave, and he'd pull out the actual comic book because he's got them all.
All right. Thanks for watching, everybody. Have a great night. Great rest of your week. See you. See you all on Friday.
Oh, I brought out that comic and I read it last night. So he would bring
I'm
in.
I'm ready to read it.
Yeah.
Let's do it now.
So he'd bring in a little of that because he would, instead of looking at the storyboard, he'd look at the posing that Dick Sprang or Adams had put in there and bring that to to play.
He did a killing job.
Right there with him.